I'm Ray Benson with the University of Arkansas Systems Division of Agriculture. I'm with the County Extension Service in Mississippi County. We're a large row crop county, and we work with producers and consultants to do demonstration of our best management practices, as well as some on-farm replicated research plots. But over the years, as more of our producers have switched to yield monitors and more site-specific precision ag equipment, we found ourselves with an opportunity to work with them and collect data that way. But over time, we've noticed some potential pitfalls and problems, mainly with how to access the data, how to get data from their equipment to a format that we can use, and then how we can make sure that we have accurate data that we can use to monitor and edit and record our treatment differences and see if we can get the conclusions that make sense based on the data that we get from the farm. So with that in mind, we've thought it best to reach out to people that can help us in terms of calibration and access of yield monitor data to make sure it's as accurate and reliable as possible. So to help us understand better how to make sure our yield monitor data is accurate, we've asked Scott Drummond to speak with us on editing and quality of yield monitor data. Scott's a former colleague of mine when I worked with USDA. He's the IT specialist with USDA-ARS Cropping and Water Quality Research Unit in Columbia, Missouri. Scott's been very involved with yield monitor data and yield monitor research since the early 1990s. During that time, he's processed tens of thousands of acres of yield monitor data to help farmers recognize the utility of this information and ways to help even delineate fields into management zones and improve the management on their farm. He worked as a group and was the lead in the development of a software package called Yield Editor, and that package helps set filters to clean and edit yield monitor data so that it's as accurate and reliable as possible. So with that, I would like to introduce Scott and let him give us some background on yield monitor data.
Thanks, Ray, for that kind introduction. First thing I'm going to talk about a little bit is the current state of yield data. And this is a question that Ray often asks me. I've got this data in format X and I need it in some other format. How do I do that? How do I get from here to there? And part of the big issue with yield data is that manufacturers change their data and their file formats often. And I can't sometimes figure out why they even do it. I mean, the state of yield data hasn't changed that much from the early 1990s, yet every time they come out with something new, they decide to change data formats. And that's a real problem for individuals who are trying to use that data. It's really to a point where there almost needs to be a standard. And so for those of you out there buying red or green or silver combines, talk to your manufacturers, let them know you really want your data and you want it in a format that is going to stay constant over time, because there really aren't that many tools out there anymore to allow you to move the data from one format to another. For example, there used to be a free tool that MapShots had out there called FO Viewer. To my knowledge, that's no longer available. And so farmers really are kind of at the mercy of their equipment manufacturer, and they get the data that the equipment manufacturer wants to give them, and they get it changed every time there's a new format change or a new software upgrade. And so that's probably not going to change until farmers start to become a little bit more knowledgeable about their data and, quite frankly, a little bit more demanding about their data. So what do you need when you say data? What do you need? Sometimes Ray will say, well, do you want me to send you some raw data or do you want me to send you a shapefile? And I'll say, well, raw data doesn't really mean anything to me. Although, does your data have position information, grain flow rate, travel and swath distances? Does it have a time interval and some sort of timestamp? Does it have grain moisture and does it have header status and transect status? If it has all of those things and it's raw data, that's great. I can use that. Okay. But what about a shapefile? Do you want me to send you a shapefile? Well, again, what's in the shapefile? And so those are the questions that people need to ask and need to know the answers to if they're going to be able to trade data formats and move back and forth with their data Okay. Despite 30 years of yield monitor development, we're really no closer to standard data formats. But if you want to work with your data, if you want to improve your data, this is at a minimum the information that you're going to need. Okay. So the next question that Ray asked me was, how important is combine calibration? And to me, a picture is worth 1,000 words. So instead of giving you 1,000 words, I'm going to give you this picture and then I'm going to describe it to you. Okay. What this is a cornfield that was harvested with two different combines. Anybody see the two different combines? I bet you could almost pick area by area, which is which. And I'm going to kind of highlight that by pointing out some of these green stripes that are right next to a red stripe. Okay. That's nothing other than two combines, one of which is fairly well calibrated and another one which is very poorly calibrated, at least in the range of yields that we're looking at here. Now, for those of you who are pretty good at the metric system, you'll realize this is extremely low yielding corn. And that often happens. Somebody will calibrate their combine in high yielding corn and or medium yielding corn, and then they'll collect data on a field like this with very low yielding corn, and they have no calibration data in that range. And so you can see that the combine that's representing this green area here is at least double the yield of the combine that's calibrated properly in that range. And so what would we do with something like that? Well, the answer is we'd probably have to come up with some method of calibrating one combine from another combine. And there are techniques out there suggested to be able to do that. And in fact, these guys in this paper did a pretty good job there. That doesn't really look like two different combines anymore. That looks like data from one type of combine. And you can see the areas where we saw the severe striping before are kind of taken care of once that second combine is calibrated well. So the question I would ask for you, if you're asking me whether combine calibration is important or not, the answer would be, which combine is yours, the calibrated one or the not calibrated one? Because you're going to get a very different answer for your yield map, depending on which combine you've got. Okay. So what we're looking at here is Yield Editor 3, which is kind of the new version of our software that we use to clean yield data. And the data that you're seeing there is data just as it would have come from the combine manufacturer's software when it was exported, okay? I can see that the delay time is set just about right from the fact that I've got these, what I call a sawtooth pattern, where going in opposite directions, my yield pattern moves a little bit left and right, okay? It's not perfect, but it's close. We're not making big sawtooth patterns within our field here. So this is not terrible data. We certainly have issues where we're entering and leaving the crop and from areas where the combine has traveled over the end rows, perhaps coming out to dump at the truck or something like that. So we've got data that shouldn't be here, but this is what most farmers are going to work with. If they don't clean their data, this would be a very good example of the data that they would start with, okay? And if we take this data and we Krieg it, which is a method of taking my point data and going to a raster grid, gridding my data, we can see we get a semivariogram here that tells us that, hey, there's pretty good spatial structure to that data. This looks like pretty good data. No problem here, okay? Here's the same data set, but I've done a couple of things. I've gone in and I've changed my delay time to 14 seconds. And you remember that sawtooth pattern we were seeing in the upper right-hand corner? No more sawtooth pattern. That edge is nice and clean. And all of these edges are nice and clean. We're getting a very good transition from low yield to high yield. We're seeing it everywhere. And in addition, I've gone in and taken out those areas where I've traveled over the data multiple times, or those areas where we're entering and leaving the crop. We're not seeing those issues. To answer Ray's question from before, is it okay to get rid of data that might be questionable? My answer to that is not only is it okay to get rid of data that's questionable, you'd better get rid of it, okay? And you're gonna see why here in just a minute. When we interpolate, when we go from this point data and we go to gridded data, we're going to interpolate, we're gonna get educated guesses at what the answers are in here, okay? If I know that I have bad data in there, I would much rather have an interpolated guess, an educated guess as to what it is, than to keep bad data that I know is wrong in that area. And so we're going to go ahead and look at what we would do if we interpolate that data. notice my semivariogram is, it's showing that there is a huge amount of spatial structure here. The nugget is much lower, the sill is much higher. We've got much better spatial structure and we're gonna get a better result. And so here is the final results to that. So the top map, or let's say the bottom map, is the one that I started with, the ones where I had the sawtooth pattern a little bit, and I had some issues at the edges of the field. This is the fully cleaned data in, put into a grid format. And people would look at that and go, well, those kind of look the same. What's the big deal? They look just the same. Why bother? Okay. Well, the answer is the average yield distance between the one that's fully cleaned and the one that's kind of default export is 3.5 bushels an acre. The max error for one of those 10 meter grids is 150 bushels an acre. That's saying one of those 10 meter grids, which is about the size you'd be working with if you were using a 30 foot planter to plant some corn, that is going to be 150 bushels off on your estimate for that one grid cell. The average absolute error is 6.2 bushels for each of them. And there are 23% of these cells that are where the error is more than 5 bushels per acre. That's a pretty significant error considering that they didn't do anything wrong when they exported this data. That's a pretty good guess at what the data looks like. They just didn't go in and remove the obviously bad portions of the data. Let's look at it another way here. What I'm showing you here are those same grid points, but now I'm just showing you the absolute error. That is how far off we are between the clean data and between the data that was just default exported. And you can see there's a lot of that map, and it's particularly along the edges and along the end rows. There's a lot of that map that is way outside, even 30 bushels per acre. And so for those areas, if you were trying to use that to do some sort of nitrogen application for next year, set some sort of yield goal, this data is going to not just be wrong, it's going to be very wrong. And for no reason other than the data really wasn't managed or handled very well. Not because the crop didn't produce in those areas, it did. But the data was covering up the real yield that was actually happening in those locations. Notice it's generally not much of a problem out in the middle of a field. We're not seeing much error at all out here. But along our edges particularly, and especially where we're entering and leaving the crop, you will get big problems if you don't take care of some of those yield errors that occur. Now, we haven't talked here about how you remove those yield errors, but I will tell you that something like Yield Editor is a great tool for being able to do that. You can learn, I can teach somebody in 15, 20 minutes how to use it, and it will take you no more than 15, 20 minutes to clean a yield of field of data, and you'll end up with a much, much better product. So the question is, I've got this data, it's calibrated, it's clean, now what do I do with it? Well, there's lots of options for how you use good yield data. You can use it for a computational layer for agricultural inputs. You can use it a set of those as layers for identifying potential management zones. Say you're looking for high yield, high stability, high yield, low stability. You can kind of break your field up however you want to break it up and decide, hey, I'm going to manage this area all as one because it behaves the same way in terms of yield. You can use it as a tool just for identifying potential problem areas. I've got this area that some years I don't get any yield in there. Why don't I get yield in some years and not in others? And the answer is probably related to water, either too much or too little, but maybe not. Maybe it's something else that you need to investigate on your field. So whether you use it in an algorithm or not, you can certainly use it in detective mode to try to figure out what's going on and help yourself that way. And another thing that people often forget about is this is a great tool for doing an economic analysis of different areas or different treatments that you have tried or that maybe you want to try on a field. In short, it can be as simple or as complex as you want it to be, and there's no limit to the uses you'll find. And the last point of that is that good yield data never goes bad, okay? You can put a crop in a bin and get a little water in there and it'll go bad, but good yield data collected properly, stored properly, never goes bad. And the value of that will continue to increase over time. That is, the more good data you've got, the more information you have for whatever type of management you want to do in your field. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Ray.
Scott, I appreciate you taking time to visit with us today about yield monitor data and how we can get the most utility out of it. Scott mentioned a lot about combine yield monitor data. That's the in the part of the state he's in, that's most of the crops that he works with. But the concepts that he mentioned would apply to any of our harvesters, cotton or combines. And we appreciate him talking with us about ways to make our yield monitor data more accurate, more usable. And we appreciate you taking time to tune in and listen to us.